Let us discuss today.
A small presentation on sleep apnea. So the pathogenesis and all will go on, and you can keep on seeing this. I'll just get the patient extubated and come back.
So let us see what happens inside when the flow of air is blocked by the passage, by the flow fall of palate or tongue or both, then the brain wakes up the patient so that he can resume breathing and can remain alive. So alive is the word. So obstructive sleep apnea was estimated till recently only as 2-4%, but it's now re-estimated at around 16% in the general population. And even a 2006 study by All India Institute of Medical Sciences in New Delhi states that almost 13% of urban Indians suffer from obstructive sleep apnea. So it's a pretty big number that we are talking about. And though we all know that obstructive sleep apnea is associated with cardiac, hypertension and diabetes risks, the maximum heart attacks, we all know, do not happen in the afternoon and evening. They happen in the late night and early morning. So why should people get heart attacks in the late night and early morning, and why not in the afternoon? So we all surely know that obstructive sleep apnea is a big reason for that. And what is important to understand is that not everybody suffering from obstructive sleep apnea is obese. Our anesthetists are encountering apnea after extubation even in normal patient. Though obesity causes more sleep apnea because of more oxygen demand, because of which more air is sucked in with more velocity. That means there is a more sucking effect on lateral walls and the airway becomes small by deposition of fat. But
मैं 155 किलो का हूँ और रात में मुझे कोई विशेष खर्राटे भी नहीं आते हैं और दिन में भी मैं बिल्कुल नहीं सोता हूँ, सुबह 5:30 बजे उठ जाता हूँ.
So this person at 155 kg is obese by every standard in the world, whereas
I had a problem of sleep apnea for almost 7 to 8 years actually, but I didn't realize that I have this problem because I used to snore in the night and get up quite frequently in the night, and it was going on for a long time, and my health was deteriorating actually, and I was feeling very weak every day. I went to a lot of ENTs over there in Doha as well, and I consulted here as well, and they gave me medicines, but which was like temporary. I didn't recover much. Last 2 months back, I was in Bombay, and again I was sick. I did this naya sleep apnea test the next day, and the results were not very good actually. I got up around 46 times in 1 hour's time, and my breathing stopped for 41 seconds at maximum, which was not really good actually.
So at less than normal BMI of 24, this guy is having an apnea hypopnea index of 46, and maximum apnea time, this time that he stops breathing maximum, is 41 seconds. So it's not just obesity, and we are talking of a lot of non-obese, normal-looking executives presenting with symptoms of obstructive sleep apnea such as snoring, morning fatigue, daytime somnolence, irritability, loss of libido, decreased performance, etc. As ENT surgeons, we cannot treat all the 84 type of sleep disorders. We can only cure obstructive sleep apnea. We cannot even treat central sleep apnea, forget about the restless leg syndrome and other types of sleep disorders. But then only we ENT surgeons can cure obstructive sleep apnea, which is a major chunk of the sleep disorder. More than 90% of the sleep disorder is snoring and obstructive sleep apnea. So because the problem in obstructive sleep apnea lies in the throat, in the tonsils, in the uvula, the nasopharynx, and if we look at the airway, the upper airway, the air travels from the nose to the back of the soft palate, back of the tongue into the larynx. So we have to understand the whole airway right from the vestibule of the nose to the inlet of the larynx. And they are distinctly divided into three regions, the nasal region, palatal region and the tongue region. So if there is a problem of obstruction in any of these region causing obstruction, so if there is an obstruction which is causing a traffic jam like this, what is the most logical solution to this problem? This or this? Obviously, this is not the most logical solution to a problem which is caused by this. The most logical solution to the problem is clearing the obstruction and clearing the airway, and that's precisely what we can do as ENT surgeons. So let's understand what are the types of obstruction present. The static and dynamic obstructions. Static obstructions are always present, so you can easily identify them when the patient is walking into your cabin in the OPD, such as the nose, big tonsils, you can see them that they are blocking the airway. But the dynamic obstruction are only present during sleep when the muscle tone reduces. So they are difficult to identify, such as the soft palate, the tongue, salpingopharyngeal fold, etc. Now, the static obstruction like DNS, polyp, turbinate, hypertrophy, and adenoids, which are also seen in adults, have to be treated, have to be removed. Because if you try to give PAP therapy to this patient, the PAP pressures required will be so high that the patient will not tolerate it. Only in case of dynamic obstruction which is present during sleep, such as the pharynx and the tongue, we can decide whether we want to do surgery or we want to give a PAP therapy. So nose offers more than 50% of the total respiratory resistance to airflow. But this resistance is transmitted throughout the airway to the last alveolus. So if somebody has got a deviated septum like this, not only is the right side, as you can see, is blocked, but also the left side, the opposite side, is blocked because of compensatory hypertrophy. So effectively, the whole nose is blocked. Or if somebody has got polyps like this, or somebody has got adenoids like this, what happens when the nose is blocked? The mouth has to remain open. When the mouth has to remain open, the mandible has to go down. When the mandible goes down, the hyoid goes behind. And when actually the patient is sleeping, the hyoid goes down. So where is the base of the tongue attached? It is attached on the hyoid bone. So when the patient is sleeping and the nose is blocked, the hyoid goes behind, taking the tongue behind and completely blocking the airway at the back of the throat. So that's like a domino. If you push on one, everything will fall. So if there's a problem with the nasal valve, a simple nasal valve surgery or a nasal strip can give the patient a great relief. If there is a problem with septum, septoplasty, problem with turbinate, turbinoplasty, you can use coblation, you can use radio frequency, you can use cautery, whatever you want to use, you can use. Adenoidectomy for adenoids like this. And in adenoids, the end point is reaching the periosteum and the buccopharyngeal fascia. And tonsillectomy. If they are kissing tonsils like this, a huge tonsil will definitely give a great relief to this patient. So, a patient who is so bad, will actually become normal by the end of the day. So, in kids, most of the obstructions are static obstruction, and the treatment of static obstruction gives wonderful results. Coming to dynamic obstruction. Dynamic obstruction are seen in the velopharynx, oropharynx and the laryngopharynx. Palate is the most common structure. Palate has got 5 muscles, 2 from the top, levator palati and the tensor palati. The job is to lift up the palate and make the palate tense. 2 from down, palatoglossus and palatopharyngeus. Palatoglossus is the anterior tonsillar pillar, palatopharyngeus is the posterior tonsillar pillar. And then there's a muscle, musculus tubuli. So the 2 muscles from the top, if you do not disturb these muscles, levator palati and tensor palati, whatever surgery you do on the soft palate cannot cause a velopharyngeal insufficiency. That is the most important thing to note. Now, how does this dynamic obstruction cause obstructive sleep apnea? To understand that, let's understand a few important laws of physics. The 2 laws, Poiseuille's law and the Bernoulli's phenomenon. Without going to physics details of these laws, let's understand that Poiseuille's law states that if a fluid, in this case air, passes from a wide bore channel to a narrow bore channel, the velocity of the fluid is increased. And the Bernoulli phenomenon states that if the velocity of the fluid is increased, the pressure exerted on the walls is decreased. That means there is a sucking effect. So in our pharynx, when the pressure is decreased in our airway, the pharynx is the collapsible area. So though trachea is the narrowest area, but the collapsible area is pharynx. Therefore, our pharynx is prone to collapse like this. And when the patient is sleeping, it's actually like this. Now, pharynx is not a elliptical, it's not a circular tube, it's an elliptical tube. The anterior-posterior diameter is less than the lateral diameter, so it's even more prone to collapse. And see how it collapses. So, this collapse causes snoring. Now, snoring is a very common feature, but what is the factor that will cause sleep apnea rather than snoring? So, in this case, the lumen size for the collapse will depend on the balance of forces of the collapsing pressures in the pharyngeal tissues minus the distending pressure of the intraluminal distending pressure. Unfortunately, the distending forces such as the tracheal tug and the dilator muscle tone are too weak and too small in number. Whereas the collapsing forces like the abnormal anatomy, the mechanical forces, gravity, Bernoulli, surface adhesion, etc. are too strong and too many in number. So our pharynx is prone to collapse. Now, what happens when pharynx is closed? What decides whether it will reopen and cause only snoring or it will remain closed and will cause sleep apnea? So that does not depend on these two forces. That depends on the third force, which is called the Starling-Wilster model. Now, this force is only applicable in collapsible tubes. I'll not go into the detail of physics of this model. I'll give you an example. If you are drinking a cold drink or naril pani with a very poor quality straw and you try to suck hard, what happens? The straw collapses, right? When the straw collapses, you try to suck harder. Does it open? No, it does not open. So what do? You push a little air and it opens up. So if you suck harder, the tube collapses. The person, when he is fat, he requires more oxygen and his diaphragm and the lungs suck harder and the pharynx collapses. Now, if the diaphragm and the lung try to suck harder, it cannot open. That's Starling-Wilster model. So see how it works. Now, this patient, as you can see here, is into apnea. He's trying to breathe. His lungs are trying to pull air inside, but in the pharynx, in spite of the column moving, it's not being able to open up. So here, howsoever hard he tries to pull, it will not open up. But if you push a little air from the top, it will open up very fast. And that's precisely the principle of PAP therapy, the positive airway pressure therapy. It gives you a little air from the top to keep that pharynx open. So it's not a good thing. PAP is a good device. Problem is that it does not give you a cure. It only gives you a control. So you have to keep this device on your nose, on your mouth, every night throughout life. And we know that in spite of all the advances in the PAP therapy in the last 30-35 years, still more than 2/3 of the patients do not tolerate the CPAP for a long time. We have to find a solution for, especially for the non-obese, normal-looking people who are having sleep apnea and we want to cure them. We do not just want to give a control. So, if you want to cure, can we cure them? And how do we diagnose what is the problem and what can be cured? So, the starting point is when they come to us, when they come with a history of sleep apnea, what study should we advise? Obviously, we advise a sleep study. So, which sleep study do we advise? Polysomnography level 1, level 2, level 3. So, what is level 1? Level 1 is a complete polysomnography with all the leads like EEG, EOG, EMG, and with all the wires, all the data in the sleep lab. Obviously, it's very difficult for patients who sleep with so many wires and in a different place. So, when a level 1 polysomnography is done at the level at the home of the patient, it's called level 2. It can be attended or non-attended. And a limited study, only cardiopulmonary study at home or hospital is called level 3, when you do not measure the brain waves. So what is the difference? Measuring of brain waves, measuring of sleep, or only measuring the cardiopulmonary is the level, the difference between level 1 and level 3. So which one should we do? If we are not sure that the patient is having sleep-related breathing disorder or not, then that means if the patient is saying he is not able to sleep, or he is having different dreams and he is having different kind of sleep problems, then you have to do a level 1 polysomnography, where you will know the sleep patterns, the parasomnia, restless leg syndrome, narcolepsy, everything will be diagnosed. But if you are very sure that the patient is having a sleep-related breathing disorder, that means if the patient's husband or wife, the spouse, tells that the patient snores heavily in the night and actually gasps for breath, then practically we are dealing with a situation of obstructive sleep apnea, then possibly we can get away with doing a level 3 study, which is less costly, less cumbersome, less number of wires, and easily available in every part of our country. So in that case, we can do a level 3 study with the understanding that it can underestimate the problem, can never overestimate the problem, so that if the patient, in spite of sleeping for 6 hours, has only slept for 3 hours, and the AHI you get is 30, that means in 6 hours, if there are apnea 30 into 6, 180 apneas the software has calculated, actually he has only slept for 3 hours, so his index is 180 divided by 3, that means 60. So we can underestimate the problem, but we can never estimate the problem. So what information will we get from polysomnography, and is that enough to cure? So polysomnography tells us how much is the problem, and the quantum it gives is called AHI, apnea hypopnea index. What is apnea hypopnea index? Apnea is more than 10 seconds of complete cessation of air, and hypopnea is more than 40% reduction in the airflow for more than 10 seconds. Obviously, this has to be associated with a desaturation, which is minimum of 3 to 4%. So, per hour, number of apneas and hypopneas tell us the severity of the problem, but not the cause of the problem. So we still, as the ENT surgeons, want to know the cause so that we can rectify the cause. And in upper airway resistance syndrome, such as in small children, as you saw earlier, in spite of the problem that the small children are having, still the apnea hypopnea index is normal. So that's called upper airway resistance syndrome. And even in young adults, we get upper airway resistance syndrome. So it's false negative, that means AHI comes to normal in spite of the person having all signs and symptoms of obstructive sleep apnea. The other limitation of apnea hypopnea index is that it does not give any idea about the site of obstruction or structures causing obstruction. So as a surgeon, you are still not sure what to do. It does not give you any prediction about the difficulty in intubation. So as a surgeon, you are interested in knowing how difficult will be the intubation and extubation, and even your anesthetist will be interested in knowing that you cannot say that an AHI of 70 will always be a tongue base and difficult intubation. It could be just a nose and the palate, patient who will be easily intubated. Whereas a person with a less AHI can have a difficult intubation. So it does not tell us whether apneas are more or hypopneas are more. So an apnea of 40 seconds with desaturation of 50% gets the same mark as a hypopnea of 10 seconds with a desaturation of 4%, which is not comparable. See here. Now this patient is into apnea, and you see that he is not able to breathe, and gradually his saturation is going down. Right, you see that the column is just not moving, it's not opening up, and after some time, the saturation starts dropping, and now, as you can see here, he is just having a little breath going inside, which is not sufficient, saturation drops further, then after some time, this patient will be gasping for breath, and he will take a deep breath, know, gasp of air inside, and then his saturation starts coming up. Saw this? Now this is almost 1 minute of apnea, which is one event. And this patient who is into just hypopnea, as you see here. Is also one event. This patient as you see here, hypopnea, more than 40% reduction of airflow for more than 10 seconds is also one event. And this patient who is actually able to breathe with so much of difficulty, as you can see here, this is secondary epiglottic fall, secondary to dangerous collapse. If he is able to maintain saturation, this is not an event. So the patient is just gasping for breath. So we understand that polysomnography has its own limitation. It tells us how much is the problem in terms of AHI. So AHI is less than 5 is normal, 5 to 15 is mild, 15 to 30 is moderate, and more than 30 is severe. So it tells us where is the problem, but it does not tell where is the problem. And as ENT surgeons, we are interested in knowing what is the level of obstruction. And what are the structures causing obstruction? So important question is how to diagnose the level of dynamic obstruction. Because static obstruction, we have been able to understand. The dynamic obstruction, how to diagnose? So there are 5 ways to diagnose a dynamic obstruction. Flexible fiber optic in an awake patient, Mueller maneuver, drug-induced sleep endoscopy, sleep MRI, and an apneagraph. So we'll discuss one by one, which tool is the ideal one. So the ideal tool is one in which we can see the structures, the size of the structures in relation to the space that they occupy, and collapsibility of the structures. The patient, when he is awake without sedation, if we look at the airway with a flexible scope like this, as you can see here, this is the pharynx, these are the salpingopharyngeal folds, this is the uvula coming in at 6 o'clock position, and the patient is able to maintain the airway patency because of the neuromuscular control, because he is awake. So an awake examination without sedation is good to look at the structures of the throat, but not the collapsibility, because obviously he is not sleeping. It's very cost effective, but not ideal and not reliable. If you give the same patient to do a Mueller maneuver. So what is Mueller maneuver? Mueller maneuver is the reverse of Valsalva. You actually close the nose of the patient. You ask him to take a deep breath inside with the nose and the mouth closed. It's the reverse of Valsalva. So what happens? You can see the pattern of closure, of the pattern of collapse, as you can see here. What is the pattern of collapse of the patient? You can see. Because the pharynx is controlled by the neuromuscular tone. So the collapsibility, the pattern you can see, but you cannot see the degree of collapsibility. So Mueller maneuver is good to see the structures, good to see the pattern of collapsibility, and that too in the velum. The degree of collapse, even in the velum, you cannot see. So it's again cost effective because you can do in the OPD, but not ideal. And it's reliable for the velum, but not for the hypopharynx. So how do we know what is the degree of collapsibility along with the pattern of collapsibility? So we do drug-induced sleep endoscopy. Simple. You make the patient sleep and let him go to sleep and snore and go to apnea. Then he goes into apnea, you put in a scope at that time and see which structure is collapsing and to what extent. So if the same patient, you give mild propofol sedation and see what happens. The patient is into hypopnea, a persistent hypopnea. With light sedation, he goes into hypopnea and remains into hypopnea. And when you give deep sedation to this patient, this hypopnea gradually turns into complete apnea. As you see, this is hypopnea, and very gradually the patient will go into complete apnea. See this. Now, after a certain time, this airway will open up.
This much was recorded actually. So I'll continue with the talk till that patient is already extubated and being shifted in the room, and then they will take up the next patient, which is a 3-year-old kid for tonsil adenoid surgery. Again, a sleep apnea. He does not have episodes of infection, and he has mainly obstructive episodes. So, okay, so. So this is what we saw, that with little more propofol sedation, the patient goes into apnea. I had actually recorded so much of presentation so that I can get some time to get the patient extubated myself, be there. What is the question? Interposter better answer. Okay, so there is a question from Dr. Anil Safaya. Anteroposterior collapse is better to treat than circumferential or lateral. So, this is a question come from the net. Anteroposterior collapse, your work becomes little easy because you can cut away that part of the soft palate. In lateral collapse, you have to do an expansion pharyngoplasty, or at least you have to remove the palatopharyngeus muscle. So unless you remove the palatopharyngeus muscle, then the lateral collapse will not be taken care of, or you can suture it on the lateral side. So Dr. Safaya, I hope I have answered your question. So anteroposterior is much easy to tackle than the circumferential or the lateral collapse, but if you are doing the right technique, then there should not be any problem with any type of thing. So coming back to the presentation, so what is drug-induced sleep endoscopy? It is good to see the structure, the pattern and degree of collapsibility of the structures, and for the anticipation of difficulty in intubation. Like this patient which we just did, we showed you the sleep endoscopy. So we knew that it is a lymphoid tongue base. It's not too much of a muscular tongue base. So valacula is not occupied by the muscles. It is occupied by only the lymphoid tissue. We saw that the epiglottis was falling because of the weight of the tongue, but it was only the lymphoid tissue. So we knew that when we lift up the tongue, will be able to lift and see it. So DICE tells you about the difficulty of intubation, and if intubation is difficult, extubation is also going to be difficult. So if it is a big tongue base and you have to, it's difficult to intubate. If you extubate the patient and the big tongue falls, it will be very difficult to re-intubate. And if the patient bleeds, then it's all the more difficult at that time. So you cannot extubate a patient who has got a very, very big tongue base, muscular one. You cannot extubate on table. Safest to keep him in the ICU with nasal intubation for 24 hours. So DICE, I just received a question on the web on that front. How do you decide what to do? And so DICE is near ideal, but it's obviously not ideal because it's induced sleep. It's not a natural sleep. Though it's not costly in nursing home or a municipal setting, but it can be quite costly in a corporate hospital setting. It's reliable and reproducible. So you can do it every time and still, you know, get the same finding. If you do it with a BIS monitoring, as we just showed you in the theater, for the anesthesia depth of sedation, use BIS monitoring, bispectral index monitoring. So if you are using BIS for DICE, then, and you know that you have not sedated the patient overly, that means the BIS is between 60 to 70. If it is not going below that, then it's not because of relaxation that the patient's tongue is falling. So it can be reproduced. Now another question on the web from Dr. Kaushal Maheshwari. My question is how to confirm pre-operatively that median glossectomy would be helpful in cases of OSA. Mean that what are the criteria for this particular surgery? Okay, so Dr. Kaushal, the midline glossectomy, you see that the base of the tongue is falling onto the airway and is obstructing. If it is with routine BIS between 60 to 70, then you are very sure that this is the structure which is falling, and once you remove the structure, the size is big, it will become better. So there is no criteria in terms of measurement, how many millimeters, because you cannot measure it by a stick going inside when the patient is sleeping. But visually, after seeing say 100 DICE, you will be absolutely sure that what is the extent of surgery that you require. But obviously you cannot measure it in millimeters or centimeters as of now. Maybe gradually as the softwares are improving, we'll be able to do that. The next few years, 2, 3, 4 years, we'll be able to certainly do that. So, how do we do drug-induced sleep endoscopy? We'll show you a live drug-induced sleep endoscopy on the next patient, because this was the first case and we had to start in time, so we did not show it to you live, we showed you the recording. But we'll show you the drug-induced sleep endoscopy live of the next palate surgery case that we have kept. How it is done? You evaluate the patient for pre-anesthetic evaluation routinely, do routine investigations. You always do drug-induced sleep endoscopy in an operating room. You don't just do it in the ward or in the OPD, because these are sleep apnea patients. If you give them sedation, it is pretty natural that they, you know, tend to sleep and their saturation starts falling. And if your monitoring is not strict, then they can collapse. And then you have to be ready to resuscitate. So you have to have, you always do it in either in the endoscopy suite, if you have one, or in your operating rooms. Oxygen, suction and airway has to be kept ready for every patient. Endotracheal tube should be kept ready, but let me tell you, endotracheal tube intubation is going to be difficult. If you have not planned and if you have to do endotracheal intubation, it's going to be difficult. Easiest is a LMA, laryngeal mask airway. Even if the patient's tongue is very big, if you put LMA, it will lift up the tongue and open up the airway. And anyway, the patient is nil by mouth, so he is not likely to vomit or aspirate. So if you put a LMA, even in a difficult patient, you will be able to ventilate the patient. Even if you have given a little more of drugs and the patient saturation is going down, you can simply slide a LMA, it will lift up the tongue and the airway will open. So LMA should be a must when you are doing a drug-induced sleep endoscopy. You always secure an IV line, and since the patient is nil by mouth, you can flush one pint of Ringer's lactate. Then injection glycopyrrolate 4 microgram per kg can be given to reduce the secretions. Many times we do not give that, but if you want, you can give glycopyrrolate. Injection fentanyl and midazolam are the commonest. Actually, when you read the literature, it will talk about propofol only. But let me tell you, the severe sleep apnea patients, I would have done maybe close to 700-800 of sleep endoscopies by now. So I started with propofol, as was stated in the literature. Then many patients, the moment you give propofol, will completely collapse. Everything will collapse. Many patients used to go into central apnea, which I called it first dose apnea. I mean, in my common language. You give propofol and they go into central apnea. They stop breathing. There's no movement. That's not the stage that we want to see. So first we give midazolam first, 0.3 to 0.5 milligram per kg of midazolam to every patient. Then we add injection fentanyl. Midazolam is a very short acting sedating agent, and fentanyl is again a good sedating agent. So fentanyl, midazolam, fentanyl in the dose of 12 microgram per kg and midazolam in the dose of 0.3 to 0.5 milligram per kg is given. And most of the patients of severe sleep apnea actually start snoring and going into obstructive apnea with this only. Therefore, I have put it on the first slide. So it is very, very safe. You are not giving propofol. You are giving only sedation, which you anyway give for your tympanoplasty cases, right? So you are used to it. Your anesthetist is used to it. And in case the patient goes into desaturation, you can always, take him out. He is not anesthetized. There is no complete relaxation anyways. Then you give nasal oxygen, 4% lignocaine with adenine. Now this is a controversial thing. I started without using any adrenaline. I started without using any lignocaine. So the problem was that the moment you put a scope into the patient's nose, they get up. They are awake. So the whole study, is of no value. Then you have to give more sedation. So I started putting 4% lignocaine patties, and that gave me better results. Now, as I started progressing doing more and more cases, and I started understanding what is static obstruction and dynamic obstruction. So this condition was similar to our ear surgery. When we do audiogram, we look for total hearing loss, which suppose is AHI, apnea hypopnea index. We look for how much is the SN loss and how much is the conductive component, right? So central apnea is like SN loss. Just for beautiful understanding, central apnea is like SN loss. Can we do anything about it? We as ENT surgeons cannot do anything about it. In ear also we cannot do anything about it. We rehabilitate by giving hearing aids. Conductive loss is the thing that we are looking at and that we can cure. So to evaluate a conductive loss, what we do? Impedance. So we always remove wax. Without that, can you do impedance? It will not be correct. Everybody will show a flat curve. So impedance tells us between ossicular fixation and serous otitis media, the difference that we are interested in knowing, or ossicular discontinuity. So once you remove wax, once you remove static obstruction, see, if you do a nose surgery, the nose is clear, then your differentiation between the soft palate and tongue is going to be better on drug-induced sleep endoscopy. So if you put a lignocaine adenine patty in the nose for 2 minutes, it will shrink the turbinates maximum. It will simulate a nasal surgery. So you know what is going to happen after nasal surgery into the soft palate and tongue. This is precisely my own observation. I have not come out with a paper on that. In fact, there is no paper. I have not written a paper so far. But this is a very, very clear observation. The difference when you do a sleep endoscopy without decongesting the nose, everything is collapsing more. So you cannot differentiate between the structure. The moment you decongest the nose, you can differentiate better between the soft palate and tongue. So if you want to use, you can use this. Then once the patient is going into sleep apnea and snoring, then you can give injection propofol gradually for the patient to snore, and you start with 0.5 milligram per kg. If you start with a very big dose, then every patient will go into apnea, central apnea. You can go up to 1 milligram per kg, but we have not required more than 50 milligram in total for any patient. Even if the weight of the patient is 100 kg, he is a severe sleep apneic, and you give 30-40 milligram, that's enough. So don't give it too much of a loading dose, give slowly, say 5 milligram or 10 milligram at a time. And then you look for at least one or two proper obstructive apneas. The patient will stop snoring, you will see paradoxical respiration, and then the patient will open up. So you see for that, and that is the moment. And if your BIS is telling the correct scores, see, don't rely on BIS as much as your own eyes and the understanding of the physiology. BIS is a very good technical thing, obviously we have discussed about that, but BIS also has its own limitations. So I do not want to confuse you too much, but don't rely only on the BIS. See, look for paradoxical respiration. That is the best thing, because the patient is attempting to breathe, that means his brain is awake. It's not central depression. And he is not able to breathe, that means the tissues are collapsing. So that's the correct point. So after the procedure is over, we give, say, a little bit of 100% oxygen to the patient, oxygenate him, wait for a few minutes, then shift him to the ward or the room. Then 2 hour nil by mouth, generally that is much more than good enough. The patient can go home when he is awake. So we have already talked about this, so I'll not go into too much of detail of that. See, 60 to 70 is the correct score. As you can see here, this patient is oxygen saturation is 99, pulse rate is 92, BP is 105/85, and BIS is 72. So this is a standalone BIS monitor. So around 60 to 70 is the correct time when you do the BIS. Dr. Anil Safaya again on the net, any false evaluations due to loss of sensitivity due to local anesthesia, like blurring of natural pressure of touch sensors? Dr. Safaya, your question is valid. There are a lot of papers on that, but honestly, I have not felt that is an issue. More than that, if you do not give good amount of local anesthesia in the nose, the patients are, they wake up pretty frequent, and you have to give more sedation. You have to give them much more sedation and take them in, which is not the correct. See, the BIS score here is 65. So 60 to 70 is the correct BIS score. You can see that it going down very gradually. So that is the correct score, 65, 64, 63, 62. Now this is the plane in which you should be looking at the fall. But if the patient is very severe sleep apneic, even at base of 75, he'll start collapsing. If the sleep apnea is very less, if he's a simple snoring patient, even at the base of 55, he'll not collapse so much. So that is the thing that I have observed, but typically between 60 to 70. Now, human beings are all available in different sizes and shapes. So, their airways are also available in different sizes and shapes. So, one size cannot fit all. Right? One size just cannot fit all. You have to tailor make the correct thing for a particular patient. So, now what do we see in drug-induced sleep endoscopy? As we see here, you can see the tonsils coming together. Okay, tongue base is not collapsing, and this is a concentric collapse, tonsils and the uvula collapsing. So this patient will do very well with a UPPP. So this is a typical anteroposterior collapse, correct? This patient is a typical lateral collapse. So you can see that there is no tongue base collapse and it is practically a lateral collapse. No, if in this case if you only excise the uvula and part of the soft palate, it is not going to respond. You have to do an expansion pharyngoplasty in this case. This is a circular collapse. So keep watching this video, it will stop here. The next case is ready. So this will, you have to do a UPPP and you can possibly add an expansion, or you have to remove tissues extensively. You can see there's a lot of redundant tissues. Yeah. But already. So I'm going up. I am starting with the next case. It's a 3-year-old kid. So we'll do an intracapsular tonsillectomy and adenoidectomy. Because it's 3-year-old kid, we cannot afford any bleeding, even secondary bleeding. We cannot afford a secondary bleeding. We cannot afford any pain because the child will stop eating, drinking. With a microphone. You can come up and see the setup. No problem. Let's finish and then you can come up. That doesn't hold true, sir. So, people who are online, just give me a few seconds. We are starting with the next case. The next case.
Pen likh karo, jaldi likh karo pen.
Huh? Oh, sir, computer system. I'll tell you. So, people who are online, just give me a few seconds. We are starting with a tonsil adenoid case. It's a 3-year-old child. And I'm just washing up. Yeah, so meanwhile I'll take some questions. What operation do you think concentric collapse? Yeah, so in concentric collapse you can choose a uvulopalatopharyngoplasty. And you can add an expansion to it, or if the posterior pillars are not very big, then you can also do a zeta palatoplasty.
Vikas,
yeah,
can we take up some questions for best time, or we don't?
Yeah, no problem. Please keep talking.
Okay.
In fact, you can. Can you shift the camera to the lower? Niche ka camera.
Dr. Ashok.
Vikas,
yeah,
put the lower camera to Dr. Ashok, turn to his side. Sunil is coming down.
It's alright. Vikas,
yeah.
While doing base time,
yeah.
Do you encounter pericondylitis or epiglottic edema after the operation?
No, see, epiglottic edema can happen if you have opened up the pericondrium. See, you saw that we respected the perichondrium almost at every place except a small part was exposed, the cartilage.
Yeah.
So, if lot of cartilage is exposed, then you can have a... No, we don't want this camera. Now, Sunil.
Hello.
Yeah, Sunil.
Ha, sir, coming upstairs.
You have to switch the camera to Dr. Ashok.
Yeah, okay.
And in next few minutes, we'll be able to start our surgery on the tonsil adenoid. Have you got a little head low?
Hello.
I'm taking the tube inside. If you get the pressure high, please let me know. Yeah, Dr. Ashok is seen. Dr. Ashok, you are seen by people.
Yeah.
And we can keep talking.
Okay. So, we are discussing about the postoperative pericarditis or epiglottic edema. Do you encounter?
No. If you respect the perichondrium, then there will be no epiglottic
edema. But sometimes it's going to be, mucosa is going to be ablated or
perichondritis. That little bit is alright.
Is all right.
Suppose it completely, then obviously there will be some
edema. And secondly, this kind of an operation. Hello?
Yeah.
Based on surgeries, this kind of patients are going to have some adenophagia or dysphagia for almost 10-15 days. So, do you need to restore the incision? Do you need in this kind of cases?
If you have done extensive work, then you need to give the restore for 2 to 3 days. In this case, it is absolutely not required.
Not required. They will be able to take orally.
Very easily. If you have done extensive muscle resection,
okay,
then you may have to give the restore for 2 to 3 days.
Secondly, while you are ablating the tissues, and if you encounter some bleeding, the coagulation will be able to perform and stop the bleeding. No?
Sir, can you repeat the question?
While doing the surgery on base time, if you encounter some bleeding, will be able to control it with the coagulation. No? In most cases.
Sorry. I was just busy with my setting up of things. Okay, is the tube pressure all right, madam?
Yes.
Can you proceed? Okay, give me the...
Good afternoon. When Vijay called me up to speak on sleep study, I told him it will be better if a chest physician who regularly does a complete polysomnography to explain on that. But he said, no, it's a ENT surgeon crowd and you are supposed to give a functional understanding of how ENT surgeons should proceed with a sleep study and how to go ahead of that. So I'll try to, in next 15 minutes, I'll try to give you an overview of how a sleep study should be approached by an ENT surgeon. So generally, it's not that you did a sleep study and that's end of the story, you send the patient for CPAP. In fact, sleep study, polysomnography in whatever levels, 1, 2, 3 we'll discuss, is only a starting point for the ENT surgeons, because sleep study is the foundation of all the buildings that we are going to form medically or surgically. Since we are surgeons, we'll definitely think surgically, but sleep study is the foundation of what we are going to make on that. Before that, we have to understand that sleep apnea is only one of the 83 sleep disorders or more which a person comes with. Once he knows that you are doing sleep work, he will come with all other restless leg syndrome, as was discussed in great detail, insomnia, parasomnias, various other things. So we cannot obviously deal with all those things in as good detail as we can with sleep apnea. And sleep apnea is only one of the 83. And even in sleep apnea, there is central sleep apnea and obstructive sleep apnea. Central sleep apnea, the pathology does not lie in the ENT domain. It lies in the brain. The brain forgets to send impulse to breathe. Therefore, the person stops breathing. So you have to give a CPAP. Like we give a hearing aid in the sensory neural hearing loss. Surgically, we cannot reverse a sensory neural hearing loss. But obstructive sleep apnea, can I have the sound, please? Can I have the sound, Jack? Obstructive sleep apnea is a condition in which the sleep is disturbed because sound check, because the airway is obstructed in the throat, palate, tongue, both. Yes, it's okay, no problem. Since the obstruction can be in the nose, palate or tongue region, we are talking of obstructive sleep apnea, and if the obstruction is in any of these region, this is the domain of ENT surgeons, and no other than an ENT surgeon can do justice to this obstruction. So if there's an obstruction which is causing a traffic jam, so what is the most logical solution to this problem? Squeezing through, or employ your equipments, clear the obstruction and get the highway free? Play it again. Obstruction causing traffic jam. Most logical solution is definitely not squeezing through. If we can clear, let's clear the obstruction and get the highway free. If we cannot do it, obviously, then we give the patient a control so that the life can move on. But if we can, we should try for a cure, because control does not go well with most of the patients. Around 70% is the statistics. They just refuse to take it. They are uncomfortable with it. So at least in the selected non-obese, normal-looking people who are having all the symptoms of obstructive sleep apnea and snoring, let's try to give a cure and not just a control. So can we cure? How to diagnose whether he has a problem worth cure or control? So which study should we advise? We have already discussed about that. Just to, for beginners, a repetition that a level 1 polysomnography is with all the channels, at least 7 as Vijay stated, with all the parameters from the brain, leg, orbits, everywhere in the hospital is level 1, which is attended by a qualified technician. If the same thing is done at home, that's called level 2. And if you do only a cardiopulmonary study, whether in the hospital or at home, it's called level 3. So that does not have the channels from the EMG, EEG, EOG, etc. It only has the cardiopulmonary parameters. So when do we advise what? If we are not sure that the patient is suffering from a group of problems called sleep-related breathing disorder, the constellation or the OSA, upper airway resistance syndrome, everything is included into sleep-related breathing disorder. If the sleep is getting disturbed because of breathing, or if the breathing is getting disturbed only during sleep, if you are not sure about that, and we may suspect that the patient can have parasomnias, restless leg syndrome, narcolepsy, etc., we are bound to, or we must advise a level 1 polysomnography. But if the patient definitely has a history supportive of SRBD, that means if the patient's spouse or the bed partner is very sure that he starts snoring heavily, and then he stops breathing, and then he takes a gasp, or he gets up, he has to sit and sleep. If you have a witnessed apnea, along with the history suggestive of clinical history suggestive of OSA, then possibly we can get away with a level 3 study. So whether we do level 1 or level 3, what are we looking at? What is the index we get? And is that enough to cure a patient? We get most important index called the AHI. So what is AHI? Apnea Hypopnea Index. What is apnea? More than 10 seconds if there is a cessation of breathing. And hypopnea, which is more than 40% reduction of the airflow, if associated with a desaturation. If a person stops his breathing for 10 seconds but does not desaturate, that's not apnea. Breath holding spells are possible. So if it is associated with desaturation, more than 10 seconds of apnea and hypopnea, more than 40% reduction in the airflow is one event. Problem is, if we calculate number of events in an hour, it tells us the severity of the problem, but not the cause. So if I have a problem in my knee, I'm asked to climb 5 floors. If I can climb 5, I'm fine. If I can climb only 4, I have a mild problem. 3, moderate. 2, severe. 1, very severe. That's severity, but that does not tell me that where is the problem in my knee. Is it osteoarthritis, tubercular arthritis, rheumatoid arthritis, or what? So it AHI gives us the severity, not the cause. That is one thing has to be understood. And it has a lot of limitations. In upper airway resistance syndrome, it's false negative. The AHI will be normal, but the patient will have all the symptoms of OSA. That's called upper airway resistance syndrome. Since the time is limited, I cannot go into the details of that. Another limitation of AHI is that it does not give any idea about the site of obstruction or the structures causing obstruction. Whether this event is happening because of the palate, is because of the base tongue, because of the epiglottis, it does not tell us anything about that. It does not give even prediction about difficulty in intubation. If you are going to operate this patient, whether a high AHI patient will be difficult to intubate, it's not necessary. A patient with a 35 AHI can be much more difficult to intubate and to operate than a patient with a 80 AHI. Why? Because that depends on the site of the problem. If a patient has only a palatal collapse and giving a AHI of 70 or 80, you put a nasal airway, beautifully you can ventilate the patient and intubate. If the patient is having a huge base tongue, even with a AHI of 30-35, the moment you induce, the whole thing will fall and anesthetist will not be able to see anything. So AHI, again, severe AHI does not mean that the patient is a difficult intubation case. Then it does not tell us whether apneas are more or hypopneas are more. Though apneas are definitely more dangerous than hypopneas. I'll give you an example. Now, this patient, you can see, is into apnea. There's no airway. Patient is into apnea, and after 10, 12, 15 seconds, he'll start breathing, and that will be one event. That will be counted as one event. Okay? So this patient desaturated a little, 5% or whatever, and he stopped breathing for 10-15 seconds, so this was one event. This patient, huge base tongue, but able to breathe because he is young. Because he is young, he has got strong muscles to pull, he is able to breathe, epiglottis and base tongue. But since he is able to breathe, he is able to take the air in, it's not an event. He is badly stressed, desaturated also, but it's not an event. So that is one limitation of AHI. Another limitation is that even an apnea of 40 seconds, 50 seconds with almost 50% desaturation will be counted equally as a hypopnea of 10 seconds with just, sorry. I don't know why it's running on its own. Apnea of a long duration with great desaturation will counted equally, will get equal weightage on this scale as a simple hypopnea of 10 seconds with a 4%, 5% desaturation. Now this patient, if you see here, you can see it's obstructive. He's trying to breathe, but it's not opening up. Now the desaturation will start. See, I'll let this video play because it's a very, very important video to see. There's no breathing till this time. It's more than 10 seconds already. Now the desaturation has started. Just a little air went inside, but the desaturation is continuing. Now this apnea was, now this is counted as 2. Because there's a little air gone, but you can see that the desaturation is still happening. This much little air was not enough. You can see that the saturation. Now he has taken a deep breath. Now too deep. See the saturation. 30. even falling dangerously to dangerous levels of desaturation, the events are counted equal to as 4%, 5% desaturation. So that is again one thing which is very. But do we have a choice? No, we do not have a better choice. So we have to continue with it till we get a better choice. I have no other choice but to trust you. That's all I can do at this point of time. It's certainly going to change in coming years. So we get AHI, less than 5 is normal, 5 to 15 is mild, 15 to 30 is moderate, and more than 30 is severe. Everybody knows about that. So what do we do next? At least it tells us where in the spectrum the patient fits. So what is the spectrum? Simple snoring to upper airway resistance syndrome to moderate mild OSA, moderate OSA, severe OSA, and obesity hypoventilation syndrome or the Pickwickian syndrome. At least we get some idea where the patient is fitting on the spectrum. We should look for the LSAT or the lowest saturation, because while doing sleep endoscopy, we know that the patient in a normal sleep always goes till 65. So we are not bothered, at least till 65. He will handle it easily. Below that we have to look for. And anyway, it gives the idea about the pressure in his system. More important is the time spent below 90% saturation, because that is more clinically correlating to the damage that is happening to his heart and the vasculature. Then we can look for the RERAs, which are suggestive of upper airway resistance syndrome, and position in which he gets apnea, as was earlier discussed, that supine gets more. So what should we do? Should we straight away go to a CPAP, or we do ENT examination? Obviously, we should try to look for obstruction if we can remove that. Obviously, weight reduction, lifestyle changes go without saying. Nothing against that. What is important is that obstructions are of two types, static and dynamic. This is a very, very important concept, because static you can easily identify. Nose, huge tonsils, bad deviated septum, turbinate. Seema has already spoken beautifully that every person has to get operated in the nose if it is contributing. Dynamic obstructions are only present during sleep. Sir, can I get two more minutes? Dynamic obstructions are only present during sleep when the muscle tone reduces. So they are different, difficult to identify. So static obstruction should always be treated. Should always be treated, because even if you give CPAP, the pressures will remain so high that the person will not tolerate. Only in the dynamic obstruction you have to diagnose whether the pharynx or the tongue or both are a problem. So, and we have to give a cure, and it should be sure shot. It should not be trying hitting here and there. And as we have seen, that one side does not fit all, and we as surgeons cannot keep trying. So we have to diagnose. We have already beautifully discussed Mueller's maneuver, drug-induced sleep endoscopy, dynamic MRI, and apnea graph. I'll not go into the detail of that. BIS monitoring, which I have started using recently, is a very, very important thing, though it is again not foolproof. The scores are not same for every patient. Eschmark maneuver, as Srinivas said, this is the Eschmark maneuver, which should be tried in all patients so that we know what is the response of sleep MRI. Seema is the right person to discuss. It has its own set of problems. Apnea graph is one thing which can give you the level of obstruction during natural sleep. For last 3.5 years, I'm using apnea graph. It is a beautiful piece of instrument where there's a catheter with pressure sensors going in the airway and measuring the airway pressures. Therefore, conclusively giving you idea in natural sleep of 6 hours, what is the level of obstruction. However, it has its own problems after using 3.5 years, I'm saying this. So though you can get an idea of the level upper and lower, it's not a foolproof thing. So what next? Message is that if the patient is really obese, BMI is above 35, morbidly obese, and you have a multi-level obstruction which is not defined, please, please, please do not try to operate this patient. The surgical risk is high. The patient's problem is air hunger. It's a multi-level obstruction. You will not be able to give this patient a great result. On the other hand, if the patient is a non-obese, just or a mildly obese, obviously 30 is a little obese, but you can define the obstruction. It is a single level of obstruction, or you can define it. Please go ahead with surgery. Definitely you will get a great result. So because as surgeons, we need to give a clear airway to the patient. Thank you very much.
Thank you.